Walter Berns was at once a scholar and a patriot. And that, unfortunately, in the contemporary world and in contemporary America, is kind of rare.
Patriotism is not natural, but has to be taught or somehow acquired. And the question was then, and I suppose still is, how was this new patriotism to be taught or somehow acquired by later generations of citizens?
On the one hand, he loved the country, thought people had to be encouraged to love it for reasons that had been stated by Walter's great hero, Abraham Lincoln, especially in a free country. It can't be taken for granted that people will simply love the country and do the things that are needed to protect it.
This was not simply the rah-rah patriotism of a war hero, which he was.
Walter was a veteran of World War II. He had served from the absolute beginning in the Navy. He had seen action. I used to like to tell my children he had taken North Africa single-handedly, when they were still young enough to believe that. And so he had a very powerful sense of what the country had been through. And Walter in particular had a sort of odyssey after World War II. But eventually they pitched up in Taos, New Mexico, where a writer's artist colony had been founded.
He was going to be the, you know, great American novelist, but then eventually he burned the manuscript. I just decided that wasn't him and wound up going to the University of Chicago. And someone told him, well, you have to take a course with this fellow, Leo Strauss. And Walter said, I'll do it next semester. And finally he did.
He was very greatly influenced by Leo Strauss, and Leo Strauss said, we should go back and read Aristotle. We should go back and read old books because we can still learn things from old books. And it's not enough to say, I don't completely agree. All right, you don't completely agree. What is it you think is right? And if you start by saying, well, no one is right, there is no right, you're just gonna go through life chortling and chuckling and being frivolous and silly, and that isn't the life Walter Berns was gonna lead.
Walter believed that true patriotism for an American includes an appreciation of self-criticism.
We are not expected to love our country simply because it is our country. Love can be blind, and love of country, like love of wife or husband or lover, can be blind too. But ours is not supposed to be a blind patriotism.
But he always insisted that our criticism of the Constitution be fully informed, that criticism had to be based upon a full understanding. And it was that fuller understanding that he spent a good deal of his life in reviving.
Walter Berns was one of a very small group of scholars who made the founding relevant again and really fundamental to our understanding of ourselves. We take it for granted now that, well, of course, if you study America, you have to read the Federalist Papers and you have to think about the Constitution and the Constitutional Convention and John Marshall, not just the latest Supreme Court cases, and you have to read Lincoln. That was not the case when Walter Berns began writing on these topics in the 1950s and into the 1960s. And he and a small group of friends and colleagues of his really revived the study of the founders, showed why you couldn't understand America without understanding the founders.
I think part of what happened to Walter and to a lot of other people is that the left changed out from under them and came to really reject the vision of the Constitution. To be a partisan of the Constitution, which is, if Walter was any kind of partisan, I think that was his party, by late in his life meant that he was a conservative by default, but I don't think he was a conservative in the way that the conservative movement understands that term. I can see how Walter would be uncomfortable with the term, and a lot of people of his generation were. But the fact is, he and they transformed conservatism in a way that made it more like them. I think what today's young conservatives mean by thinking of Walter as a conservative is purely a compliment. It means that they see themselves shaped by his teachings.
Walter Berns was at AEI when I came here in 1986, and he was here for all of my tenure as president, up until his 90th birthday. He was in the office every day. Right up to the end, he was the complete intellectual and the archetype of what AEI has always tried to promote and insinuate into larger political debate.
When Lincoln was a young man, he gave a speech about the Founding Fathers in which he called them a forest of giant oaks. And I thought Walter very much represented that image. These were people in the founding whom Lincoln felt had greater challenges than his own generation. Walter Berns was one of the giant oaks Lincoln spoke about. And he's left an extraordinary legacy for those of us who are still here at AEI, his scholarship and his great strengths as a colleague and friend to many here.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for being here and to helping us remember Walter Berns and celebrate the Constitution. I'm Yuval Levin. I'm Director of Social, Cultural, and Constitutional Studies here at AEI. And it is my great pleasure to welcome you to what is the 12th annual Constitution Day lecture held in honor of the great Walter Berns. We honor Walter in just the way that I think he would like to be remembered, which is we come together to think about the Constitution. And we do it each year with the help of someone particularly well-placed and gifted for helping us do that. That is very much the case this year. We could really hardly ask for a better guide in thinking together about the Constitution than our speaker tonight, Judge Neomi Rao of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia. Judge Rao is, for one thing, a public servant of the highest caliber. She's served in all three branches of government. She was a Senate Judiciary Committee staffer. She worked in the White House Counsel's Office. She was the administrator of OIRA, the Office of Information Regulatory Affairs at OMB. And of course, she's been a judge since 2019. She's also a real scholar jurist. She not only has all of that experience in government, but she's taught and studied and written about an extraordinary range of constitutional issues, particularly as a law professor at the Antonin Scalia Law School at George Mason University, where she also founded the Center for the Study of the Administrative State. In public service and in scholarship and in jurisprudence, she's really a model of the kind of judge that our republic requires and needs. We're lucky to have her where she is, and we're grateful to have her with us tonight. Judge Rao's lecture is entitled Pluralism and the American Constitution. And after her remarks, she and Adam White of AEI will have a conversation about the subject, and then we'll open things up to questions from all of you. Those of you watching online, you can find kind of right next to the video you're watching the email address or the Twitter hashtag where you can send questions. And with that, help me to welcome Judge Neomi Rao. Judge Rao, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, you all, for that very kind introduction. It's really a pleasure to be here at AEI to give this storied lecture that so many remarkable jurists and individuals have given before me. So some of my law clerks are here today, and I asked them to help me find a joke to start off my speech. And they came up with nothing, but one of them did try ChatGPT, and I'm not sure quite what they put in, but maybe something like constitutional law joke in the style of Judge Rao, and nothing was funny. So I think I'll just start off tonight's lecture about pluralism and the Constitution without a joke. So today, our public discourse often focuses on the divisions in American political and social life. We hear a lot about polarization, the decline of trust, and the breakdown of our institutions. America is one of the most diverse and vibrant countries in the world, with a long tradition of religious and economic liberty. Yet there are signs everywhere that we are less able to appreciate and respect difference, and importantly, less thoughtful about what such diversity requires from our government and our courts. And so on this occasion, celebrating Constitution Day, I want to recover the relationship between pluralism and our constitutional tradition. By pluralism, I mean the inherent differences between individuals, which may be expressed through their interests and talents, their religious beliefs, and their chosen work. The framers of our Constitution recognize the inevitability of human differences in the pursuit of happiness. This fact of pluralism was deeply connected to individual liberty and served as an important animating principle behind the specific form of government established by the Constitution. Tonight, I want to elaborate on this theme in three parts. First, those who shaped our Constitution had firm and passionate beliefs about what was true in religion and politics. They were certainly not relativists. But they recognized that others, perhaps in error, would invariably hold different firm and passionate beliefs. For instance, Madison recognized that as long as the reason of man continues fallible, different opinions will form. And because it is inevitable that the American people will hold different opinions, interests, and beliefs, the Constitution was designed to accommodate pluralism by protecting individual liberty and establishing political processes for representing and negotiating the varied interests across society. Second, I will discuss the vitality of pluralism in our constitutional tradition and in the Supreme Court's jurisprudence. Just this past term, the court struck down Harvard's affirmative action program, holding that such racial discrimination runs afoul of the Equal Protection Clause. Justice Thomas explained that maintaining a pluralistic society requires equal treatment by the government, not divisive and arbitrary racial preferences. And finally, I'll consider how the administrative state has undermined the constitutional protections for pluralism. The original progressive faith and expertise is fundamentally at odds with pluralism. Moreover, moving lawmaking out of Congress and into executive agencies has unraveled one of the primary institutions for negotiating our pluralism. Agencies cannot replicate the legitimacy and process of our representative legislature. When private ordering is replaced with public ordering, local control replaced by national control, and legislative control replaced by administrative edicts, those whose ideals are not reflected in the regulatory policy of the day invariably feel marginalized. The penetrating reach of regulation into all manner of social, religious, and economic activity often occurs with little regard for pluralism. When legislative majorities are lacking, the administrative process may intensify political distrust and polarization and strain the shared enterprise of our constitutional democracy. Restoring the legislative power to Congress would help to realign the administrative state with the original Constitution. This would further the rule of law, and it might also reinvigorate the political process necessary to peacefully accommodate pluralism in our diverse and vibrant nation. So let me begin with the founders' understanding of pluralism. The founders acknowledged and accepted the inevitability of human difference, and they created a constitution that accounted for pluralism by structuring and limiting government in order to protect individual liberty, property rights, and minority interests. The political philosophers influential on the framers recognized the inevitability of human difference across matters of conscience and economic interest. For instance, John Locke described and recognized the deep pluralism within and across human societies. It was a fact, he said, that was necessarily assumed. He maintained that although there are objective principles of natural law, human consensus on moral and legal matters was unlikely. It is precisely for this reason that individuals must come together and establish a government that can mediate their differences in a peaceful way through a legislative process aimed at the general welfare. Inevitable human diversity also required protection for private property and individual rights. Similar ideas about the social contract and the necessity of law were expressed by Blackstone, Montesquieu, and Hobbes, to name just a few. To be sure, neither the founders nor the natural rights theorists they relied upon were relativists, and they did not always agree about the benefits or burdens of pluralism. Yet they recognized that diversity was inherent in human nature and reflected in our varied interests, beliefs, and pursuits. The diversity was particularly manifest in matters of conscience, which required the free exercise of religion. As Madison emphasized, the religion of every man must be left to the conviction and conscience of every man, because it is the right of every man to exercise it as God may dictate. George Washington similarly stressed that the conscientious scruples of all men should be treated with great delicacy and tenderness and extensively accommodated. Pluralism was also apparent in individual talents and interests. As Madison recognizes in Federalist 10, there is diversity in the faculties of men from which the rights of property originate. The protection of these faculties is the first object of government. From the protection of different and unequal faculties of acquiring property ensues a division of the society into different interests and parties. The latent causes of faction are thus sown in the nature of man. The primary accommodation for such pluralism was ultimately structural and political. The Constitution begins with Article 1, which vests all legislative power in a collective Congress, a representative legislature in which different viewpoints could be expressed, debated, and ideally harmonized into a legislative solution consonant to the public good. As I have elsewhere explained, the Constitution vests legislative power in a collective Congress in order to create a government that brings together all the disparate interests of society and creates laws that further the general good, avoid corruption, and protect the rights of individuals. Political theorists and historians have long debated whether the founders envisioned that the legislative process would identify an objective common good or simply would negotiate different interests. But either way, there was widespread recognition that Congress was the central institution for mediating diverse and plural interests across society. While the legislative power was essential for negotiating pluralism, the Constitution established other structural protections for personal liberty. These included federalism and the separation of powers, a unitary executive, and an independent judiciary to uphold the rule of law. These structural safeguards were supplemented by the careful enumeration of specific individual rights, such as freedom of speech and religious exercise, as well as protections for private property. Pluralism is a deep fact of the human condition, and the framers didn't seek to level out pluralism. Rather, in the spirit of liberty and prudence, they established a constitutional government designed to secure the welfare and prosperity of a growing and diverse nation. Next, I'd like to explore the essential connection between individual liberty, constitutional rights, and pluralism that runs through many of the Supreme Court's decisions. Individual liberty and pluralism are, in a sense, two sides of the same coin. We care about individual rights precisely because each person is unique, and all men are created equal and endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights. By upholding the structure of the Constitution and enforcing individual rights against the government, the judiciary can help to maintain a peaceful, pluralist society that protects each individual's life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. A few examples demonstrate the vitality of pluralism in our constitutional tradition and in the Supreme Court's jurisprudence. The theme, first of all, frequently runs through the decisions upholding the First Amendment's protections for freedom of speech and religion. As the Supreme Court has said, no official, high or petty, can prescribe what shall be orthodox in politics, nationalism, religion, or other matters of opinion. This past term, in 303 Creative, the court held that Colorado could not require a website designer to create expressive designs for same-sex couples. Justice Gorsuch proclaimed, "The First Amendment envisions the United States as a rich and complex place where all persons are free to think and speak as they wish, not as the government demands. The Constitution requires government even-handedness and tolerance of different viewpoints." The government, of course, may speak as it chooses, but it cannot dictate the speech and expression of individuals or interfere with the free marketplace of ideas. Freedom of speech is particularly important for unpopular ideas, and as Justice Holmes said, to protect the speech we hate. Maintaining free and open debate further promotes robust democratic deliberation. Pluralism also animates many of the Supreme Court's religious liberty cases. Free exercise frequently involves stating the importance of protecting minority religions. And while Establishment Clause jurisprudence for many years promoted secularism rather than religious pluralism, in recent years the court has emphasized that the government cannot force religion underground or promote policies hostile to religion. For example, in the 2019 American Legion case, the court upheld display of a peace cross that was part of a World War I memorial. As Justice Alito explained, the religion clauses of the Constitution aim to foster a society in which people of all beliefs can live together harmoniously. From a somewhat different perspective, Justice Kagan's concurrence emphasized this nation's pluralism and the values of neutrality and inclusion that the First Amendment demands. The 14th Amendment extended the constitutional commitment to equality and pluralism that was promised, but not fully realized in the original Constitution. The Equal Protection Clause protects pluralism by prohibiting government discrimination and forbidding the creation of racial castes between citizens. Supreme Court decisions in this area have historically been somewhat mixed. But last term, in Students for Fair Admissions versus Harvard, the court invalidated Harvard's affirmative action program. As Chief Justice Roberts explained, the Equal Protection Clause prohibits discrimination on the basis of race, and eliminating racial discrimination means eliminating all of it. In his soaring concurrence, Justice Thomas explicitly linked equal protection of the laws to pluralism. He noted that our Constitution protects individuals, not racial groups or classes. The Declaration of Independence set forth our national creed that all men are created equal and therefore must be treated equally by the government. Affirmative action, he said, was simply naked racism that promoted a factionalism based on ever-shifting sands of skin color and racial category. Justice Thomas continued, rather than forming a more pluralistic society, it strips us of our individuality and undermines the very diversity of thought that universities purport to seek. By upholding the equal protection of the laws, the court protects the rights of individuals, and it prevents the factionalism that results when the government divides up its citizens and distributes benefits and burdens on the basis of race. The Constitution's structural protections, federalism and separation of powers, are also inextricably linked to individual rights and accommodating what Madison called the great variety of interests, parties, and sects across our republic. As the court has said, the federal structure allows local policies more sensitive to the diverse needs of a heterogeneous society, permits innovation and experimentation, enables greater citizen involvement in democratic processes, and makes government more responsive by putting the states in competition for a mobile citizenry. Federalism secures the freedom of the individual. In a pluralist society, federalism provides more opportunities for representative politics and leaves space for important issues to be worked out by individuals in their local communities. In Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health Organization, the Supreme Court recognized that Americans held a wide range of viewpoints about the morality of abortion and the appropriate scope of abortion regulation. In overturning Roe versus Wade, Justice Alito explained that the Constitution was silent on matters of abortion. He emphasized, "It is time to heed the Constitution and return the issue of abortion to the people's elected representatives. The permissibility of abortion and the limitations upon it are to be resolved, like most important questions in our democracy, by citizens trying to persuade one another and then voting. That is what the Constitution and the rule of law demand." Through the proper exercise of judicial review, the Article III courts help to preserve a vibrant pluralism by upholding constitutional rights and maintaining the structural limits on the federal government. The Supreme Court, however, has failed to uphold the structure of the Constitution with respect to perhaps the most essential protection for pluralism, namely the vesting of all legislative power in Congress. Congress provides the mechanism for umpiring our inevitable disputes and resolving them through the lawmaking process of bicameralism and presentment. Representation of different interests in the House and Senate promote deliberation and ultimately the identification of policies that will serve the general welfare. The legislative process in Congress is not perfect, but it's fundamentally legitimate, representative, and accountable in a way that executive lawmaking can never be. And so this brings me to the modern administrative state and my final point about the particular ways in which the administrative state threatens the peaceful pluralism protected by the Constitution. To begin with, the progressive ideology behind an expansive administrative state is at odds with pluralism. The original progressives who advocated and advanced the modern administrative state, Woodrow Wilson, Frank Goodnow, and others, they began with the faith that experts could find the right answers to social and economic problems. And having found the right answers, experts could and should impose them on the American people. The progressives did not concern themselves with individuals and the inherent differences between individuals that were part of the human condition. Instead, they emphasized social problems and reaching the best social policy and organization. The original progressives candidly advocated sidelining the messy and unscientific legislative process and weakening judicial review. For administration to succeed, Americans would have to move beyond the Constitution's archaic protections for individual liberty and private property. In short, the administrative zeitgeist is fundamentally at odds with pluralism and the protection of individual liberty. It cannot accommodate diverse interests, opinions, religious beliefs, and economic pursuits. The founders emphasized moderation, fallibility, and individual liberty. The progressives, by contrast, pressed for science, certainty, and government control. But the threats here are more than theoretical. The administrative state's constitutional problems, I trust, will be familiar to this audience. And so my focus today is on how these constitutional problems exacerbate polarization and factionalism. Reaching into nearly every facet of social and economic endeavor, the modern administrative state has unraveled the Constitution's structural protections for peaceful pluralism. At the most fundamental level, the administrative state has shifted policymaking from Congress to the executive branch. The Constitution vests all legislative power in Congress, yet in practice, what looks very much like legislative power is today primarily exercised by administrative agencies. Why is this a problem? There are many reasons, but one of them is that Congress was designed to represent and mediate the many different interests and concerns across our diverse society. Disputes would be channeled into legislative politics that would be widely representative of many intersecting and competing interests. Because securing such agreement would be difficult, federal intrusion would be minimal, and most decisions would be left to private ordering or to state and local regulation. Lawmaking is hard, and it was designed to be so. As Justice Gorsuch explained in his concurrence in West Virginia v. EPA, lawmaking was vested in the people's representatives so that those who make our laws would better reflect the diversity of the people they represent and have an immediate dependence on and an intimate sympathy with the people. Executive branch agencies lack this type of representation. Agencies are staffed by subject matter experts and bureaucrats drawn from a narrow knowledge class. Siloed in their areas of expertise, agency staff often act as policy partisans. They simply do not represent the diversity of interests across American society, and they are institutionally not well suited to recognize the broader economic and social trade-offs of regulatory policy. To be clear, it's not necessary to vilify the bureaucracy in order to recognize that their experience and sphere of action is narrow, specialized, and aimed at particular bureaucratic ends, rather than a holistic consideration of the general welfare. Modern proponents of the administrative state often argue that it can promote so-called constitutional values, even when running afoul of the actual Constitution. But the reality is that the regulatory process can't come close to approximating the representative politics of Congress. Sure, notice and comment rulemaking allows the public to weigh in, but the process usually involves only those with deep pockets and the most intense interests. Cozy regulatory capture is prevalent. And in any event, proposed rules often change little before becoming final rules, irrespective of the hundreds or even hundreds of thousands of comments that are filed. Agencies often impose a singular solution on deeply contested matters without the political deliberation, negotiation, and legitimacy of congressional action. Those who disagree with an administration's policies have little opportunity for representation in the regulatory process and little hope of stopping policies that trample on their beliefs or interfere with their economic livelihood. Agencies are structured to allow the energetic pursuit of an administration's policies without the compromises of congressional lawmaking. While unitary energetic execution is part of the constitutional design, energetic lawmaking is not. And so our government intrudes into more areas of private life and with less political legitimacy. An expanding administrative state that imposes one-size-fits-all solutions to contested questions raises the stakes of disagreements in a pluralist society. Consider a few examples in which the Supreme Court has found that agencies invaded individual rights or exceeded their legal authority. Regulatory policy often fails to accommodate religious exercise. For instance, the contraception mandate imposed by the Health and Human Services under the Affordable Care Act required all employers to provide for contraception, and it provided no exemptions for those with religious or moral objections. The Supreme Court held that this violated the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and because it imposed the mandate against private employers with sincerely held religious objections to such contraception. As the court said, eradicating the authority to provide a binding national answer to this religious and philosophical question, HHS in effect tells the plaintiffs that their beliefs are flawed. For good reason, we have repeatedly refused to take such a step. Agencies also often stretch or exceed their statutory power. For instance, during the COVID-19 pandemic, the Center for Disease Control imposed a nationwide eviction moratorium, which the Supreme Court invalidated. The court explained that the moratorium went well beyond what Congress had authorized, intruded on the landlord-tenant relationship, and claimed an unprecedented federal power. As the court said, our system does not permit agencies to act unlawfully, even in pursuit of desirable ends. And the court stressed that Congress, not the CDC, had to decide whether the public interest merits further action. The Supreme Court also invalidated the recent regulatory plan to forgive student loans because the policy exceeded the authority granted by Congress. The Chief Justice explained that under the government's interpretation, the Secretary of Education would enjoy virtually unlimited power to rewrite the Education Act and unilaterally define every aspect of federal student financial aid. Furthermore, the court noted that this is a case about one branch of government arrogating to itself power belonging to another, but it is the executive seizing the power of the legislature. The secretary's assertion of administrative authority has conveniently enabled him to enact a program that Congress has chosen not to enact itself. These cases dealt with issues of great importance involving contentious moral questions and matters of social and economic significance. And the court recognized that such major questions must be addressed in the first instance by Congress. Nonetheless, so far at least, the court has shied away from a more robust enforcement of the non-delegation principle. Some justices have cited stare decisis and other practical considerations for avoiding non-delegation. None of these reasons, however, addresses the fundamental fact that the Constitution vests the legislative power in Congress, not some of it, but all of it. As I have explained in my scholarship, widespread delegations have undermined the collective Congress and its incentives for checking executive branch agencies. This failure of the political process bolsters the need for judicial review to restore the constitutional limits on administration. Justice Thomas and Justice Gorsuch have called for the court to check the delegation of legislative power to the executive. If the court enforces Article I's vesting of all legislative power in Congress, it would uphold the separation of powers and protect individual liberty, all the better to serve the needs of our diverse and heterogeneous society. So let me conclude here with just a few more thoughts. It is at bottom inevitable that Americans will disagree about many social, political, economic, and religious matters. As the founders recognized, such disagreement is sown in the nature of man. Madison said it would excite astonishment and admiration if Americans could peaceably, freely, and satisfactorily establish one general government when there is such a diversity of opinions and interests. So on Constitution Day, it is worth recalling that the founders recognized the inevitability of human diversity, and they accepted pluralism as a social and political fact. They responded to its challenges by establishing a government structured to promote individual liberty and the general welfare. At the center of this structure was Congress, a legislature carefully designed to represent the nation's diverse opinions and interests through collective lawmaking. But the ubiquity of administrative action and the lassitude in Congress have strained our political mechanisms for mediating difference. The erosion of the original Constitution, the breaching of its limits on government, the blurring of the separation of powers, and the reversal of the Federalist structure all make it harder for a diverse society to function and to identify shared goals. Restoring the constitutional limits on the administrative state would be a good in itself. And it just might go a long way to restoring a more peaceful pluralism in our country. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Judge. When you first told us what the topic of your Berns lecture would be, my AEI colleagues and I were very happy to hear it. The themes that you've been discussing have been central to a lot of our colleagues' work. Phil Wallach, your friend, my colleague, has a new book out titled Why Congress. Jay Cost has a new book out called Democracy or Republic. And others are working along similar themes. But the more I've been thinking about your remarks, the more it strikes me this is a very Walter Berns lecture, in the sense that there are deep Lincolnian themes in what you were discussing, so much from Lincoln's first and second inaugural addresses, themes of union among deep difference. They're timeless, of course, and American, but also Walter Bernsian, and so grateful for your remarks. One last thing, you mentioned at the outset, previous speakers in this series. I think when AEI announced this lecture series in 2012, I think Justice Scalia spoke at that event. Our first Walter Berns lecture was the retired judge, Michael McConnell. More recently, Judge, now Justice, Brett Kavanaugh, who also, I think, his remarks were on Chief Justice Rehnquist and the non-delegation doctrine. So now we have two non-delegation themed Berns lectures, which I'm very much in favor of.
Judge Kavanaugh's seat, so, you know.
You know, I like the trend line on this, by the way. But thinking about the conversations we've had over the years, these are themes we've talked about over the years, but now you've been a judge serving for a few years. I'm curious, how has your service as a judge further shaped your sense of pluralism in American government?
Well, I think that there is a deep connection between respect for pluralism and the rule of law. And, you know, I've obviously thought a lot over the last 4 or 5 years in a pretty intimate way about the proper role of a judge. And of course, the role of a judge is to uphold the law. And I think when judges are doing that in the right way, when they are upholding the Constitution, upholding statutory limits on administrative agencies, which is a big part of my job, I think that leaves space for pluralism, right? It leaves an opening for individual liberty. It keeps the government within its limits. And I think that, so I think there's a really an important connection between pluralism and the rule of law, and therefore in the power of judicial review.
Now, often criticism of judges over the years has been that their work is not rule of law enough, that they treat their job as more of a sort of making value judgments on behalf of the American people. And even now, in recent years, as the Supreme Court has touched on a number of the issues that you discussed in your remarks, there's been criticism that the court itself is imposing value judgments, maybe disagreeing or imposing itself in what should be a more pluralistic process for deciding the nature of constitutional rights. What do you make of those criticisms? There are some who would say that, say, the Harvard case, for example, the more pluralistic approach would have been to let colleges choose what they're going to do and let everybody choose differently. But this is a case where the Supreme Court saw the rule of law at stake.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think there are some choices that, of course, our Constitution doesn't leave to the political process. And that includes protections for individual rights. It might be more pluralistic to let universities discriminate on the basis of race, but that is forbidden for government actors. The equal protection of the laws means no discrimination on the basis of race. So there's sort of a balance. I mean, where the Constitution leaves choices to the political process, for instance, on the matter of abortion, then there is, you know, the court leaves space for pluralism, for political pluralism. On the other hand, where the Constitution protects individual rights, it's incumbent upon the court to enforce those rights against, you know, popular majorities.
Now, I was struck by your criticism of the administrative state, not because I haven't heard you speak or write on those things before.
It's all about the administrative state. Well, everything is always about the administrative state.
This is why we get along so well.
Yeah.
But, you know, you were sort of in the administrative state, so to speak, for
yeah,
a time.
Yeah, I was, sure.
Your predecessor,
I'm very familiar with the administrative state.
That's right.
State.
Well, sometimes familiarity breeds contempt, so maybe that's it.
Yeah,
but
could be.
There have been efforts to instill greater plurality pluralism into the administrative process among Democratic and Republican administrations alike, including your service in the Trump administration. There were executive orders and other efforts to bring more voices into the process. So I was struck by your comment that in that process, it's almost inevitable that particular voices will dominate, whether it's the biggest interests, whether it's the technocrats themselves. Is there really nothing more that administration could do to make itself more pluralistic?
It's a really good question. So when I was the administrator of OIRA, we did put in place a lot of reforms that would hopefully improve the administrative process and bring different interests to bear. And a big function of OIRA, of course, is to provide a broader perspective on regulatory policy. But one of the things that became pretty apparent to me in running that process is that a lot of these solutions are second best options. So yes, we can make regulation more, we can make it more accountable to the public. We can bring in different voices. We can try to make it approximate something like the legislative process. But ultimately, it's not structured for that. And the way that regulation is formulated and pursued is fundamentally just very different from a legislative process where you have political representatives negotiating and compromising over what our public policy should be.
In the very beginning of your remarks, you said we often focus on polarization. And we should focus on polarization. I wonder how pluralism can actually work in a polarized society, right? The national slogan, out of many, one. It feels like now it's more out of two, one, right? Or maybe among two, one, where you have two, at least in our political matters, two ideological political parties. Even in our federalism, it's not as though we have 50 different solutions so much as one set of states that follow one set of solutions and the other states follow the other solutions. How does polarization work into this? Can we have genuinely pluralistic institutions, especially Congress, when they really seem to be organized along bipolar red and blue lines?
Well, I think if Congress were the institution that had to make major policy decisions, then perhaps we might see more compromise and we might see more negotiating on important issues. But instead, so many of these important questions are shifted off to the administrative agencies where they can be made in a kind of singular focus. So I think if all the energy was focused on the legislative process, it's at least possible that there would be more compromise and negotiation. And at the end of the day, our system was designed for the federal government simply to do less. And if the federal government did less, I think that would also maybe mitigate some polarization and dissension because the government would not be interfering with private ordering in so many ways.
And in terms of how Congress has gone about its work and delegated power to the agencies, thinking about some of those laws, in some ways, ironically, the laws that delegated the most power to agencies and by your argument, sort of did the most to undermine pluralism in practice. And the statutes themselves were deeply pluralistic. That's why they passed by such large majorities. The Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, to speak in broad generalities for the sake of good ends. It's in a way, I guess, the failure to not just agree to really compromise and deliberate and get into the details that has undermined Congress's work and thus pluralism. And I guess that's a failure of Congress really digging down and doing its job beyond platitudes. But enough about Congress, maybe. One group you haven't spoken about so much in talking about institutions is the people themselves. Mm. What does genuine pluralism in constitutional government require of citizens?
I think the framers assumed that, a constitutional democracy would require people of a certain amount of good character, right, who in good faith participated in the political process with their fellow Americans. And that level of toleration and accommodation of people who have different views is really essential for our democracy to function properly. And I think recovering some of that might go a long way to easing some of the problems that we see.
In eras when either the Supreme Court was perhaps stepping outside of its lane and imposing value judgments, and now the administrative state overstepping its bounds to impose value judgments, how much of that is a willfulness on the part of those institutions, and how much are they just filling the vacuum left by Congress or left by the people themselves?
I mean, I think agencies are oftentimes just doing what Congress designed them to do, right? They often gave them a mandate, a very open-ended mandate, and staffed them with tens of thousands of people. And so in some ways, it's unsurprising that we get what we get. So I think it's in some ways a natural outgrowth. I mean, in the Trump administration, we tried very much to stop regulatory overreach, but in some ways that is perhaps contrary to the natural tendency of administrative agencies.
Yeah. And maybe one last question of my own before we open up the floor. Do you have a sort of an ideal statesman? Maybe it's a judge, somebody who's worked in the executive branch, somebody who's worked in Congress, who you think exemplifies in American history the values that you're calling for a return to now?
Well, I mean, Justice Thomas, probably one of the greatest living Americans that we have. He came up from such dire and impoverished circumstances to be where he is. I think he has served also in the highest reaches of the executive branch before going on the bench. I think he understands the importance of pluralism and the connection between pluralism and individual liberty in a very deep way.
Okay. And who's your least favorite? No, just kidding. So again, we can take questions not just from the people in the room, but we have people watching online live, and they can submit their questions via email or in that great bastion of pluralism, Twitter. The instructions are on the event page. If you raise your hand, the questions will find you. We'll start, the microphones will find you. We'll start with Robert Doerr, and then the next question will be right here.
Judge Rao, thank you very much for those great remarks. You made it sound so easy, pluralism. And did you not want to acknowledge that sometimes politics is frustrating, reaches the wrong conclusion, has fits and starts and stops, that there's a lacking of efficiency sometimes? Could you at least acknowledge that it can be that way?
Oh, of course it can be that way. Perhaps it was designed to be that way at times. Politics and Congress are, it's certainly not perfect, but it is the system that we have, and perhaps it is one of the best ways for negotiating compromise across a pluralist society. But no, it's not a panacea.
Next question will be right here.
Hi, my name is Andrew Zach. Thank you so much, Judge Rao, for your remarks today. So you talked about pluralism in a lot of different realms, but one of those realms I think that you didn't really touch on so much was the legal realm, and I think it's increasingly clear, not just in academia, but on the court itself, that there are a number of approaches, both outside of originalism, but also within originalism, towards kind of reaching results. So I was kind of curious, how do these different approaches factor into your role as a judge on the DC Circuit Court, and what would your advice be to judges, attorneys, but maybe also younger people who are interested in law, when approaching those different ways of understanding texts or the Constitution?
Well, I mean, I'm an originalist and a textualist, and I think that's part of the judicial role, is to interpret the law for what it says, not for what I wish it said or what I hope that it might say. And yes, there are tendencies from all different quarters of American society that are asking courts to impose singular solutions from one direction or another, or seeking the same thing from the administrative state. But especially with respect to the courts, it seems like this was such an obvious thing a few years ago to simply say that the job of the courts is to say what the law is. And I'm a little surprised at how under attack that simple premise has become. So I guess I'll just reiterate it here. That's certainly my view of what the courts should be doing.
More questions, please, but we'll circle back to Robert's question for just a moment. It's not just that legislating is hard, it's also and messy and partisan, but there are big, big things at stake, fundamental judgments of principle, fundamental moral values, and it's easy to say members of Congress should compromise, but we all get upset when they compromise their principles. How should they approach that? How much of what's before Congress is a matter of first principle that they should never compromise on, and how much of it is details where you can split the difference?
Well, I'm not a lawmaker, so. No, but I mean, you know, it's a balance, of course, right? Like, you know, like anything. I do think, I mean, legislating is a bit of an art, right? I don't know if it's a science. It's probably more art than science. Yeah. And I do think that the way our Constitution was structured, when they couldn't negotiate or find some agreement, then the government simply didn't act. And that's also an option. Maybe we no longer think that's an option, but it seems like that was the default, was that things would just be left as they were.
Yeah, I saw more hands up. Okay, so the next question will be here, and then right here.
Hello, Judge Rao. Thank you for your remarks. My name is Atman Vakil. My question was about federal and state relations and how do they impact pluralism and what the Constitution has to say about it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Sure. Well, I mean, I do think federalism is an important aspect of pluralism. I mean, the idea was that most issues would be left to state and local control, and that would promote pluralism because people within their communities could participate in more local political processes to govern themselves. And so I do think that the erosion of federalism has been detrimental to our pluralism.
Nice question right here. It's coming to your right, sir.
Hi, Judge. Thank you for your remarks. My name is Sam Owens. I wanted to ask a question about standing, in particular thinking about the...
Standing?
Standing, mm-hmm. Yeah. The Biden student loans case, for example, there happened to be like a legal entity that checked all of the right boxes to have standing in that case. But it seems like on the horizon, there's kind of this big question of if the administrative state, really, there are like these big seizures of power and there's not an entity that clearly has standing. There are a bunch of complicated doctrines around when you can sue the administrative state, sue the government. What do you see as being like the way we're gonna solve those challenges? Like as the president or the administrative state overreaches more and more, how do you resolve those thorny issues around standing?
You know, that is a great question. That's probably one I shouldn't speak about given how many cases I hear that involve that precise and evolving issue. But it is a great question.
Great. Other questions here, and I think I saw another hand over here. No?
J.P. Hogan, you're running into climate change. The progressives had used a global we. Global citizen, and sort of, I think that's trying to neutralize pluralism. So just, are you running into pluralism versus them trying to standardize people as a global we, and that's part of the problem?
Well, I guess I'm not sure if I'm entirely following your question, but I do think, I mean, globalization can be a way of eliminating pluralism, right? I mean, if you have global solutions, that's even more leveling of pluralism than having a national solution as opposed to a state or local solution. So I think that is certainly a possibility.
I mean, it is interesting. A genuine pluralistic political process requires acknowledging both what we disagree about but also what we share in common, right? What actually drives us to want to negotiate, compromise, come together. And the more that people, either in government or people outside advocating for government, see themselves as having more in common with whether it's regulators abroad, judges abroad, political actors abroad, and seeing that as more of the we rather than the Americans right there in their own neighborhoods, their own states, their own country that they disagree with, probably makes it more difficult to have pluralism, right? Because they find themselves more tightly bound to these people outside of the political community than the neighbors across the street that they they actually are of a community with. Mm-hmm. Gary Schmidt, here in the front. It's making its way.
Thanks for your remarks. And as somebody who generally agrees with the criticism of the administrative state, I'm also, you know, struck by the degree which one of the deep parts, the most important policymaking elements of the administrative state is the Federal Reserve. Mm. It obviously makes major decisions that are, that, you know, Congress has no role in whatsoever. How do you fit that in within your sort of constitutional vision?
Well, Adam and I have a bit of a disagreement about independent agencies. I'm not sure that they really exist, but he believes they exist.
I do. I've seen them.
You've seen them. Yeah. I mean, you know, that's a little bit of, I mean, that's a different problem from what I talked about here, but I do think the Article II problems of the administrative state are very real. I mean, Article II vests all of the executive power in a singular president, and then we have all of these agencies that operate outside the control of the president, like the Federal Reserve, although oftentimes the Federal Reserve is considered a special case from other independent agencies. I guess I won't opine on that, but I do think, you know, the lack of presidential control is another serious problem with the administrative state.
Last question from the audience will be right here.
Could you elaborate on why the fact that the president is elected every 4 years is not a sufficient protection of democratic legitimacy and pluralism?
Well, I do think that presidential control provides a certain kind of accountability for execution of the laws, right? And for setting the direction of the administrative state. And that, all of that is incredibly important and vital to making sure, you know, the administrative state operates in at least somewhat of a constitutional way. But I do think that type of presidential control can't fix open-ended delegations to agencies, right? Because the executive isn't a lawmaker. And so the fact that the president was democratically elected doesn't make up for the fact that there's none of this representative politics in the making of the law. And I do think, and I've written about this elsewhere, but there are really deep reasons why lawmaking has to be done by a legislature. And the founders and the political theorists they relied on talk about this a great deal. And the protections that you get from representative lawmaking just are simply not present in the executive.
You know, it's a fitting question to ask at this event. One of some of Walter Berns' most enduring work was his study of the Electoral College and the way in which that institution was created to help advance a kind of pluralism, at least in the selection of the president. Maybe one last question for me, Judge. In your service on the court, you're not just deciding, you know, often divisive or controversial issues, but you're doing it as a kind of group project. You're deciding these cases in a panel of three judges. When it's en banc, I guess you'd so a group of
11.
11 judges now. And just in the last few weeks, you've written high-profile majority opinions, unanimous opinions, in cases that often would divide Americans politically or their sense of government. What have you learned about pluralism from just serving alongside and along with judges with whom you often deeply disagree?
Yeah, I mean, it's been, you know, I am grateful that I have such wonderful colleagues on the D.C. Circuit, and I think we do often agree more often than is sometimes portrayed. And, you know, I mean, I did have several quite controversial cases that were decided over the past year and that were published. And the panels were very diverse, you know, ideologically in the way that people talk about that, and yet also unanimous. And I think that should hopefully give people some faith that what we're doing is following the law.
And just to be clear, you've written some dissents, too.
Some dissents, yeah. Although not as many as most years, so. Yeah.
Well, please join me in thanking Judge Rao.
Yeah. Thanks so much.
And there'll be a reception right outside the door.